Yeah. morning and welcome to St. John the 23rd. Please rise and join us in singing Christ is Risen, Shout Hosanna.
This morning, as we do all things, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Good morning, and welcome on this first day that really feels like spring. As is our custom, I'd invite you to say hello to those around you. If you don't know somebody, perhaps even introduce yourself.
Hi.
My dear sisters, my dear brothers, let us humbly beseech the Lord our God to bless this water he has created, which will be sprinkled on us as a memorial of our baptism. May he help us by his grace to remain faithful to the Spirit we have received. Lord our God, in your mercy be present to your people's prayers. And for us who recall the wondrous work of our creation and the still greater work of our redemption, graciously bless this water. For you created water to make the fields fruitful and to refresh and cleanse our bodies. You also made water the instrument of your mercy. For through water which Christ made holy in the Jordan, you have renewed our corrupted nature in the bath of regeneration. Therefore, may this water be for us a memorial of the baptism we have received through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. May your people exult forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that, rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
First reading is from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter said to the people, "The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and denied in Pilate's presence when he had decided to release him. You denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked that a murderer be released to you. The author of life you put to death. But God raised him from the dead. Of this we are witnesses. Now I know, brothers, that you acted out of ignorance, just like as your leaders did. But God has thus brought to fulfillment what he had announced beforehand through the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be wiped away." The word of the Lord.
Show. A reading from the first letter of St. John. My children, I am writing this to you so that you may not commit sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is expiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but for those of the whole world. The way we may be sure that we know him is to keep his commandments. Those who say, I know him, but do not keep his commandments, are liars, and the truth is not in them. But whoever keeps his word, the love of God is truly perfected in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Luke.
Glory to you.
While they were still speaking about, the two disciples recounted what had been taking place on the way and how Jesus was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. While they were still speaking about this, he stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." But they were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. Then he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do questions arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, because a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you can see that I have." And as he said this, he showed them his hands and feet. While they were still incredulous for joy and were amazed, he asked them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of baked fish. He took it and ate it in front of them. He said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and in the prophets and Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the long and growing list of things that I'm not particularly good at, I have to admit that I really struggle in academia. And this didn't hit me until I was a grad student in history, and our urban history seminar, our professor started talking about books. And he was sharing this method he has for sorting, scoping out, and evaluating books. And this includes doing a background check on the author, where the author went to school, what the PhD dissertation was on, the style of history, what the reviewers said in the academic journals, who those reviewers were, did my professor know those reviewers, and on and on and on. And I'm sitting in this room full of my peers, and they're all sagely nodding at this, and I'm feeling like a Neanderthal, because honestly, the only way I have ever thought to evaluate a book starts with reading the book. Now, there's a certain level of how can we make this as difficult as possible mindset that does run through professional academia, and that's inherent in my own being as well, I have to admit, but mine runs more towards the ruinous procrastination, overscheduling, and a way overactive imagination. So while I can accept not having enough time to read all the books that I want to read, I'm certainly not going to take that time to research new books so I can add them to the list in the proper places. Now, this meant that, for me, seminary, with its overriding focus on philosophy, also was overwhelming in many ways. Some people take the philosophy naturally. I am not one of them. I spent my time hanging on by my fingernails, smiling and nodding in what I hoped were the appropriate places, and usually starting to figure out what was going on about halfway through the next semester. There was a saving grace, though, because in between history school and philosophy school, I attended counseling school, which is a completely different beast. Now, I know there are fields like neuropsychology and scientific psychology that actually use a scientific procedure when interacting with people, but my focus was counseling psychology, where really we make it up as we go along. Basically, try something until it works, and then keep using it until it stops working, and then keep trying other things until you find what works again. So while writing a paper for one of these courses, I came across phenomenology, this subset of philosophy that explores how different people experience sensory input and interpret the world. Wow, I thought. This might help explain why some people fall into addiction and some people are able to recover while others keep relapsing. So this was my happy thought all through seminary, that I would be able to piece together enough phenomenology that I would eventually be able to understand what it was that helped me get sober, not relapse, come back to Catholicism. If I could understand how this all happened, then I'd be able to explain it to others in language that everybody could understand. We bottle it, sell it, and make a gazillion dollars. That's what I thought. Instead, a few months before ordination, I came to this crashing realization. I don't get it. I don't need to. I'm never fully gonna understand all the mysteries that surround our faith. God is with me, and that's all that really matters. And this has been, for me, a source of great amusement, but a certain frustration in our RCIA groups, because we've had so many people coming from the hard sciences and engineering who are interested in Catholicism. These are people who make things work. They want to know how the pieces click together. And I tell them every single year, yes, sorry, there's not much going on up here. Whole lot down here, but not much up here. So I'm really struck by our first reading when Peter says this. Now I know, brothers, that you acted out of ignorance, just as your teachers did. But God has thus brought into fulfillment what he had announced through the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be swept away. Peter didn't come to this level of wisdom through Christology, phenomenology, or having a system to register the books that he hadn't read yet. No, Jesus told him. It was that simple. I know without any doubt at all that most of the troubles in my life, especially surrounding addiction and mental health, were exacerbated by my resistance to asking for any sort of help. There was a constant longing deep in my heart that I could feel and I couldn't fill, no matter how stupid I tried to do things. And I wasn't going to admit weakness, so I never looked for help, therefore making my life as complicated as possible. It wasn't until after I stopped fighting the idea that my parents might be right about faith that everything just sort of started clicking into place. Why? Because Jesus told me. Reading scripture with an eye towards fulfillment in Christ, praying with fearless honesty, and accepting myself as a child of God, flaws and everything, but God seems to care anyway, those were the three main ways that I was able to open my soul so I could hear Jesus telling me, this is so. How often do we try to make things more complicated in our lives? this faith thing really is, in my experience, one of those things that is fairly simple and is summed up when we start the creed. I believe. It really is as simple as Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. God made us. God cares for us. God would like to help support us as we support this creation that God created that we are living in. I don't need phenomenology to tell me that my experience of God has been one of saving and supporting and challenging me to be more than I thought I ever was. I didn't need seminary to tell me that a good chunk of my life was made more difficult by acting out of proactive ignorance. I didn't need anything but to invite Jesus to open my mind to the scriptures. Now I'm not just here, but filled with gratitude for the chance to be able to share this with everyone who cares. Are there places where we're making our own lives more complicated than they need to be? Why is that? How can we invite God in to remind us that God simply loves us? As people of faith, we rise and share our common creed. I believe
in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, God, Son of God, Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, God not made,
consubstantial with the Father,
through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven,
and by the Holy Spirit,
the incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man.
For our Savior was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death
and was buried,
and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven, and seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in
glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
I believe
in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son,
who with the Father
and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church.
I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead,
right on the world's come.
Jesus was made known in the breaking of the bread. Our minds and hearts are open as we pray.
That the church be ever thankful for the gifts of the earth and the graces that flow from the real presence of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That government leaders revere the sanctity of life from conception to natural death, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the unemployed and underemployed be comforted by God, who knows all needs and the longings of their hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those in a prison of isolation be welcomed and comforted by the hospitality of a loving community, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the members of this congregation, united in love and service, be perfected in the love of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all of us, especially the students, faculty, and staff of the University of Tennessee, will remember that all knowledge and wisdom is a gift of God to be used for the good of all, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the parishioners of John 23rd, for whom this Mass is being offered, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We now invite you to offer your own petitions.
Lord,
Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all those prayers we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, hear us as stewards of these Easter mysteries. We offer these prayers in the name of Jesus, our resurrected Lord. Brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Amen. Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant church. And as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. He never ceases to offer himself for us, but defends us and ever pleads our cause before you. He is the sacrificial victim who dies no more, the lamb once slain who lives forever. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Of your glory.
are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you, in thanksgiving, this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, St. John the 23rd, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people that you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children, scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Peace of Christ with
behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy to enter into your
presence, but only say the word and my soul shall be saved.
May the body and blood of Christ keep us safe.
Yeah.
Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you were pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So the 4th Annual Spirit of Hecker Awards will be broadcast on Facebook and YouTube on Saturday, April 27th at 8:30 p.m. And this program is to honor exemplary leaders and volunteers from the parishes, centers, and ministries where we serve, we Paulists serve, in the spirit of our founder, servant of God, Father Isaac Hecker. And the theme of this year's program is advancing God's mission through our charism and community. And this year, St. John the 23rd is very proud and pleased to award Jerry and Charlie Mulligan, longtime parishioners who've really spearheaded social justice around here, as well as students Josh Adkins and Delaney Klee, who are the co-directors of our student group. So we yes, absolutely. We thank you for your generous donations to the CRS Rice Bowl Fund. If you've not yet brought in your rice bowls, please do bring them in next weekend. And a many thanks to all of you who volunteer in so many different ways to make St. John the 23rd such a remarkable place. Our parish appreciation dinner will be on Friday, May 3rd at 6:30 p.m. right here. We do ask that you RSVP by scanning one of the QR codes that are around the building, because it is a catered event. And it's going to be a big night, because not only are we celebrating volunteers, we're also celebrating Father Bob's 50th anniversary of priesthood, Father Don's 30th anniversary of priesthood. We will be saying goodbye to Father Don at that night. We will also be saying goodbye to Deacon Dan, who we thought we'd made a big enough down payment on, but apparently he's getting repossessed by the Paulists. Speaking of not paying our bills, Father Don would like to have a word with us.
Okay. As you know, I tend to try to do a quick little thing on finances about twice a year. Well, the last one, we sort of had that snowstorm and that disrupted thing a little bit. And it looks like I won't be here after the end of this next fiscal year to be able to give you another one. So I thought, well, let's do the first 9 months. So this is our first 9 months of this fiscal year. And, you know, again, we want two priests on staff, quality of worship, living wages, good stewardship, especially keeping the building going. So those are our goals, of course. And but just to let you know, here's our sources of income. Half of it is just the Sunday collection, envelopes and loose cash. Another good chunk is from electronic giving. And then there's stocks and IRA contributions that we see. Then there's targeted donations, like given specifically to the building fund or things like that. We get money from parents, alumni, and also football when we sell the football. You know, we park so many cars here during football weekends and Sunday school and such. Their investment income from our savings, and then special collections which go to the diocese, then religious ed student activities, including things like awakening, where the students are paying part of that and things like that. So costs, well, okay, priest salaries, insurance, benefits, that's a chunk, and then lay and music salaries, insurance and benefits. Diocese takes a chunk, and then there's rectory maintenance and parish maintenance and all the utilities and the automobiles, then special collections going out to the diocese, liturgy, supplies, things like that we need, and parish life, so things like socials and Sunday suppers and all those things come out of there, just so you know it. And then there we do donations, different charities and pastors' discretion kind of thing. And so that's where the money goes. The numbers are there, pretty small, but you can sort of see them. I will have a PDF version available for the people who get our email. So that one. And this gives our sort of how the year, the first 9 months is going, ups and, you know, expenses and then regular and one-time gifts. What we end out at this point year to date is we're just slightly in the hole. Sometimes we're up at this point, sometimes we're a little down. But what this means is if the next 3 months are normal expenses and normal giving, we're probably going to end out the fiscal year around $45,000 in the hole, with a deficit of about $45,000. reason for that is things are a little more expensive than they were, salaries a little higher. We've also lost a few people because parking is a little more difficult. Okay, it's a lot more difficult, but some days especially, right? And so things like that. So we want to be thinking about that, especially going forward, and especially, guess what? The new pastor gets to deal with some things. So ongoing things, you know, we have Focus Missionaries, Awakening. We have charity that we do, Vault Catholic Student Group. Now we have UT dorm construction and ongoing parking issues. We're still working on, we've got like the picnic tables for out front, but we need to install them yet, and things like that, improvements that we want to do there, just sort of are on the scale. But otherwise, you know, we had the roof replaced and all that kind of stuff all done. So it's, you know, the building's in, I think, pretty good shape at this point. But if you have any questions, you can talk to me. If you want numbers, we can even do that, or talk to any of our finance council people, and they can sort of fill you in on anything. So, thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May God Almighty bless you abundantly, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
And as our bishops have asked, we pray.
Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. Be thou, Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls.
And for our own bishop, praise
to you, Lord our God, our eternal shepherd and guide. We know that all the Lord comes from you. With confidence in your promise, we entreat you to join our diocese of Knoxville, a new shepherd after your own heart. In your love for us, send us a shepherd who will lead us in being Christ's heart of mercy, voice of hope, and hands of justice. Help him to fill the minds of our hearts with the truth of the gospel, the power of God, the sacraments, and the desire to build up your loving church. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Holy Spirit going on today.